Welcome back, everybody. It's a pleasure to welcome Toshendra Sharma, who is our next speaker. Toshendra finished his M.Tech here in IIT Bombay in our department, working in the area of application security. Even as he was a student, he founded this company called Vigilant in 2011. His company makes cloud-based security products for enterprises. It's a startup that was incubated here at IIT Bombay. Just on a personal note, I found Toshendra one of the most enthusiastic kinds of people I could ever find. He really has tremendous hands-on experience, and because of that, I've asked him to make a presentation. In fact, this is I ask him to make a presentation in almost every of my courses. Since there was a question on SQL injection and XSS, I thought he has many presentations with him, so I thought it might be most appropriate to continue that thread on SQL injection. Some people had a question. He has actually shown us how he can hack into sites around the world and so on, all live. I don't know whether he's going to do that today. I hope he does, assuming the internet is working here. And I think you will really have a wonderful time listening to him. You will probably not want him to stop. But of course, he's a busy man these days, and we'll have to wind up. But let's hope we can encounter him again in one of these things. Okay, with that, a big welcome to Toshendra Sharma.
Hello, everyone. My name is Toshen, as sir has told us. So I'll be talking about the web application security, and as you all must be aware that in web application security there are two major attacks that we have, and these major attacks are SQL injection and the cross-site scripting. So today I'll talk about some practical aspects of the SQL injection rather than the theoretical aspects, so that we can learn or see how web application can be hacked. So we can see that how real-time and actual live web application can be hacked and how we can actually defend them. So we'll consider the both things about like how to attack and how to defend, as well as see what are the programmatically we can sort it out and how in programming we can make a little bit change and make our application secure. So I'll start with the presentation. And so now the first question is simple. What is it? What exactly SQL injection is? So as you might have thought about that, SQL injection is means somewhere we are injecting the SQL, or SQL is nothing but a, you know, structured query language which help you in fetching some data from the database through some non-procedural way. So SQL injection is the alteration of SQL command, SQL command's purpose without knowing the users or the without knowing the developers that these changes has been occurred. So you can say the alteration of SQL command's purpose by injecting some special string through the user's input. So for example, there is a user input called username and password. So if you want to enter the username and password, so rather than entering the username password, a hacker can actually provide anything. Anything means he can even provide the SQL commands in place of the username. So what if the username directly goes to the server and gets executed as like normal user, but actually it is a SQL query. So rather than as processing it as a user, it will access it as a SQL query and will execute the query. So that query can be anything. It can even damage the whole table, whole column, and it can even drop the whole database. So now you can say that injecting a complete command with or without the other letters through the user's input into the database engine may call SQL injection. So it's simply providing something which developers generally do not expect. So we provide whatever we want to send, and then people and the program or the application will accept it as a authenticated input and will process it. What is the problem with that? Like, okay, so suppose user has provided an input and we have just accepted it without considering that it might be an SQL query, then what is the problem, right? So the malicious command can even drop the whole table and database, as I have already mentioned, and the complete control of the database to the hacker. That can also be given by, you know, leaking the username and password of the database. So as you can see, very simple cartoon here, over here. It says that, somebody named their kids as a Robert, single quote, bracket, terminator, drop table, students, terminator, hyphen, hyphen. So it means that whenever this name will go into the database, this will actually try to execute two different queries. One is the Robert, and the second one would be the drop table students. So that drop table student, the second query will actually drop the table from the database, and anyone, even the, you know, organizations or companies who are using it may lose the complete data or information. So now who is responsible? The question is, okay, SQL injection has occurred because what? Because what? So what would be the exact reason for having the SQL injection, and who is actually responsible for defending these, and who is its responsibility to make it very much secure? So I would say the reason for SQL injection is the no proper sanitization of user's input while feeding the query into the database engine. So the idea is simple. Whenever you are taking something from the user, you supposed to consider that it might be malicious. So whenever you are taking an input from a user, consider that it might be malicious, sanitize it, filter it whenever as much as you can, and then process it. Otherwise, do not accept it or discard it. So now sanitization means simply, like for example, I'll give you one practical example. What if you are getting a letter from an unknown source, and then you are just accepting whatever is coming inside the package and you are taking it into your home, considering that courier service are not going to filter your box or not going to see or not going to scan your boxes. So obviously you will never accept a box from the unknown source and just keep it inside your house, because it might be a bomb, right? So it's simply, and it's very similar to that, whenever you take an input from a user, no matter what kind of user you are taking, always and always sanitize it, always filter it, consider that it might be malicious, and then only proceed to the server side processing like SQL query execution or whatever you want to do. Okay, so now sanitization, as you might be aware, that in the all web application there are two entities, which are, one is a server, one is a client. So now the question comes, where we need to exactly do the sanitization? Either it should be on the server or it should be on the client, right? So client means, if we want to do the sanitization inside the browser using some JavaScript, so that is called client side sanitization. And if you are doing the filtering the query or filtering the user input into the server inside the server side scripts like PHP, JSP or Python, then it becomes a server side sanitization. So what is the ideal condition, whether it should be both or should be either client side or either server side? Then I would say it should be both, because it will give you the extra layer, but the ultimate requirement is server side. You cannot miss the server side sanitization at any cost, so otherwise your application will be hackable, definitely. Now I'll give you the very small example in the PHP. So as you might be aware, that this is the one example where people are actually taking the input which is coming from the get password, or you can say get array. So in the PHP there are two methods to send the data variable to the server. One is get, another is post. In get we actually show the variable name into the URL, like for example this is a URL, okay, and then URL, and then there is question mark ID is equal to some XYZ, right? So this XYZ is actually the query that people are going to pass to the server. So this method is called get method, right? So whenever you are passing this executing this URL, this variable ID will be available in the server in the PHP under this variable name get, which is an array, and then you have to pass the index, which is ID. So now you can access the incomplete variable which XYZ has been passed. So suppose if you are taking the XYZ into the database and just processing and executing some query, definitely it might create some problem if the XYZ is actually the script. Then it will create a huge problem for you. So now the idea is, we need to make sure that whenever somebody is sending it to the server, before doing any further processing, we supposed to call a function, whatever you call it, sanitize. So this sanitize function will actually make sure that whatever is coming from the get has been sanitized, and then sanitize function will return it to the get ID. So now the ID will be safe, and then now using the ID further in your application will be considered as secure enough. Now if you go to the application, so as you can see, we are taking the ID from the get variable and storing it inside the ID. We are taking the password from the get variable and storing it inside the password, and executing a very simple query, select star from users where user ID is equal to ID and password is equal to password. Means we are trying to check whether any row exists in the database where user ID is equal to provided ID and password is equal to provided password. So this is simple case of username and input validation. and then we are executing the query and expecting some result. So result might be number of queries or whatever the exact row. Suppose we provide in place of password, what if we provide this string? One single quote space or space single quote one single quote is equal to single quote one. What if this is the password? What if the user, rather than entering his actual password, he is entering this virtual password? So as you can see the query in the next slide, the string. So in place of password, I just replace this string, the whatever we have provided, and make the exact SQL query, right? So now you can see, if you execute this query, select star from users where user ID is equal to ID and password is equal to 1 or 1 is equal to 1. So this condition, which is the on the right hand side of the AND operator, will become a tautology and will always return true, because either password is equal to 1 or 1 is equal to 1. So this is very, very sure that 1 is always equal to 1. So this will return true, and the user ID is equal to whatever ID you provide, you will log in. So this is a simple case where you can log in to a user admin panel or wherever the user are without actually providing the real password. You can provide this special string and then log in. So I have a simple demo for this. I'll show you some live website where I can log in. As you guys can see, this is a very simple HTML form where you can just provide the username and password, whatever the password is, and then submit the form. So the server will send you the response. Either if the username password is correct, then it will give you the login success. Otherwise, it will give you login failure. So for example, I'm going to provide the right password. So now you can see there's a login success. So now I'm going to provide, rather than this actual password. So as you can see, this whatever the password you provide, except the real password, it will always give you login failure, right? So now, rather than providing the actual this wrong password or the actual password, I'm going to write a very creative string. And then try to execute the query. So if it is an SQL injection, then it will give me the login success result. So now you can see login successful, because the query has become a tautology and it has returned true. The only thing you need to be correct is the username has to be correct, and that's it. So username is mostly available nowadays, so you can always access the pages. So there are lots of live pages available on the internet. I have some of them. So I'm not sure if it is a good idea to show someone's admin panel here live. So we'll skip that. So rather than this, we can, I think, show it here in this way. Okay, so I think you might have understood that what is the SQL injection and how it works, how it can actually modify the query's original purpose without impacting the any other things in the program or without impacting the functionality of the program. So now, as you can see, what is the difference, like how we can solve it, right? So now how we can solve it means how we can protect our application. So it's very simple that wherever you see this, whenever you are taking the input from the user using the $get or $post or $file, or there are many other 5 or 6 arrays by which you can take the input from the user, always sanitize it through some sanitization methodology, which are mostly available in form of the MySQL _scape_real_scape string function. So I'll show you the practical code snippet, which is secure and which is insecure, in a live demo. Okay, so now what type of SQL injections are available nowadays? So we'll say union based SQL injection and the blind SQL injection. So now union based SQL injection are nothing but a method of making two queries executing at the same time using a union operator, and then in the second query we'll perform whatever operation we want to perform for our own purpose. So like, for example, suppose hacker wants to run a select star query on a database without impacting the actual functionality of the application, then it has to perform the using the union operator and then perform the whatever query and perform in the second query. Now the blind SQL injection, what is the blind SQL injection? I think I should explain about the blind SQL injection once I show the union based SQL injection demo. So we'll go back to the browser. Okay, I have one live website. Okay, so I'll show you some of the examples here. So I'm going to load the URL first. So I have installed one small plugin or add-on in the Firefox, which is called a hack bar, which will help you in executing the query in a very arranged and very structured box manner. So now this is the URL which I'm going to execute. So I'll just click on execute. Okay, so we'll execute this query and we'll see that the normal page actually loads. So there is a product description, there is a clear window sticker, whatever. So they are showing a lots of things on the page about the price and all. So these are things might be coming from the database because they are pushing, they are pulling the category ID from the URL and then showing the content based on the category ID. So what I'm going to do to check whether this page is vulnerable to the SQL injection, I'm going to put a single quote at the end of this and we'll try to execute. And once we execute, we'll see a certain abnormality in the page. So now you can see there is a warning, which means there is an error in the page based on the SQL injection. Okay, so now why this error is coming and what is the meaning of this error? Now as you know, I provided only the single quote at the end of 2 and the query has shown some abnormal behavior saying that query could not be executed and MySQL underscore fetch underscore array is actually expecting a result parameter, but we have provided something null or something empty. Why this is happening? Because of providing the single quote in my query, the actual SQL query has been interrupted and the single quote has caused the query to break in between. This means the single quote which I have provided using the URL or the get method, this single quote has been passed to the database engine and has been executed. Means there is no sanitization available in the database. So or the in the server side script. So it means if there is no sanitization available at the server side, means there is a possibility of SQL injection and we are going to exploit it. Okay, now after this, what is the step? What is the second step? So the second step would be to identify the number of columns in the page by using the order by query. So what we are going to do is we are going to delete this and we'll type order order by suppose 50 for example. So this will try to run the query and will try to arrange the column as per the column number 50 only and only if it exists. If it does not exist, it will give you an error. So if you see, we'll again see an error, right? And it means this query does not exist. And if we try to execute the column number 5, the page is loading normally, it means column number 5 exists in the table, whatever is executing this query, right? So now we have a good opportunity to identify using the binary search method whether what are the number of columns. So I'll try with 20 and we'll see if the error comes. So if the error comes means 20 does not exist and the column number should be between 5 and 20, right? So now we'll try to execute somewhere between 10 and we'll see. So this is a very simple search, binary search. So now we have an error, so means something between 5 and 10. So now we'll try with 8. Okay, so we have a query again. So it means somewhere between 5 and 8. Let's put 6. So we are trying to identify the number of columns available in the table. Okay, so the answer is 5. So there are 5 columns in the table. As you can see, the 6 is throwing an error and the 5 will show you no error. So there are 5 columns in the table. Now the next step is going to be the union, which I was talking about the union based SQL injection. So what we have to, what we will be doing is exactly we will be typing union select 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So we will type up to 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 because there are 5 number of columns. So I'll explain you the meaning of this. So it's simple that we are trying to execute one extra query besides the original query using the union operator and we are passing the select 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 and where 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 are nothing but a small number. In the SQL, if you will execute select 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, it will return 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 numbers as it is. Means if you are not going to provide any table name whose column this query must be expecting, then it will give you the exact number. So we are just trying to execute a very dummy query and we'll try to see what comes. So we are actually expecting the numbers in the page, right? So let's see what happens. As you can see, there will be nothing and it will show you no changes. So no changes means the query has executed successfully And now what we need to do, we need to suppress the original query by pressing either -2 or putting some null, so that the original query should return 0 or null result, and our query, which is the right hand side query of the union operator, should return the number. So if you will try to execute, you will see the numbers in place of the title. So where the numbers are there in place of the title, it means this title was coming from column number 1. So this position was column number 1. So now we have a position where we can see the results of our query, and we can process the other attack. So now I'm going to do is, I'm going to put in place of 1, I'm going to put version and bracket. So this is a simple version function which will help you in identifying the version of the MySQL which this website is running. So if you will execute, you will get the version number of the MySQL. So now we will start with the risk attack. Now we know the position where we are actually going to reflect this information. So as you know that we can see the information on the page, that's why it is not called blind SQL injection. And blind SQL injection is something where you will not be able to see the output in the page in form of some visible outcome. You will only see the response or the result in form of the timing, the load timing, or the size of the page or something like that, but you will never see the result in form of the text like this. So this is not the best blind SQL injection. So now after the version, what we can more we can see is, we can see the database which the website is using, and if we execute this, so now we have elastic_db is the database name. So this is very simple. Now we have a database name. Now we'll craft our queries accordingly, so that we can see the table name, because after the database name, we need to know the table name. So to know the table name, what exactly we need to do is, after this query, we need to type some this string. So now as you can see that we are executing the query, which is after 5, we are typing the from space or plus sign. So place and space and this both will work. From information_schema.tables, where table_schema is equal to database, right? And only one change we have to do is, in place of the database, we want to concatenated list of tables. So what we need to do, we need to type group underscore concat, and here we'll type table_name. And then 2, 3, 2, 3, 4, 5. So what this query will do is, it will execute the query which is after the union, and will try to select the concatenated table names from the database, from the list of tables where the database is actually the current database which we are running. So because there are always a 2, 3 database which are standard, which we are not using, so it might give you the list of huge tables, so we are not going to use it. So we'll execute the query and see what we have here. We have the list of tables of this website. So as you can see, the admin_user_information is one table, categories is one table, and category details is one table. So there are 3 more tables, and I think we can also see. So as you can see, there are more tables. So around contact us also, there is one table. So I'm going to use, I think as you can see, there is one table which is looking very interesting, is this admin user info. So we are going to use this table to identify the column name of this table. So now we'll focus on this table only. So for getting the information of this table, what we need to write is, we need to type in place of table name, we'll be typing column_name, and also we'll type a separator. We'll try to have one separator here so that we can see the all column name separated by a certain value. So we can type 0x3a, whatever the special character it has, it's an ASCII value. We are providing a hexadecimal value, and then after this, what we have to provide is from information_schema.columns rather than tables, because this information_schema.columns are the superset of the all columns exist in the database. Okay, so now we have information_schema from columns. where table name now in place of table schema, we'll use a table name because we are want to focus on a particular table. Admin underscore user underscore info. Okay, so we'll try to execute and see if there is some output we receive. Okay, so now we have good output. We have the column name of the tables admin underscore user underscore info. So now we are interested in what? Obviously username and password rather than user ID. Okay, so okay, let's see all these three things, right? You admin user ID, username and user password. Or let's say focus on the admin user ID and password only. Okay, so for that one, what we need to do is, okay, so in place of group concat where we have had the column names, we'll type username and then separator comma user password, because we are wanted to these two things together. And then from direct a table, right? Because we know the table name exactly, so we can now focus on the exact table name. Sorry, from okay, so now we have username and password of separated by a semicolon of the admin of this website. So this is good enough for us. We can now go and do whatever you want on this website. So this is just for the educational purpose and to demonstrate that how bad it can be to, you know, for a website or for a web administrator, for a enterprise to, you know, defend their websites against the hackers. And this is a very simple attack. This is a very, very simple attack, and more complex and more creative attacks are available for SQL injection, which can even kill your entire information you have on your server, and even it can even shut down the entire things. Okay, so now SQL injection is done. I'll be focusing on the now cross-site scripting, which is I'll be showing some demonstration on cross-site scripting only in the local machine, and these demonstration will show you how the cross-site scripting can affect the website and can create a problem for the web administrators. So now the cross-site scripting, so people have as heard about this thing many times, right? What is the cross-site scripting? So why it is called cross-site and why is it scripting? So cross-site scripting means where you are targeting the or running the script from one side to the another side without actually having the access to the other side. So we are actually cross-communication between the two sides in terms of running these client-side scripts on the server. So it is always all about the client-side script attack, but it looks client-side, but it is very, very dangerous attack. It can even cause the web application to shut down because of the so many creative exploits they have. So we generally call it XSS, or sometimes some people call it CSS. So web definition of the cross-site scripting is very simple. So it's a security hazard that allowed crackers to interfere with your program's logic by inserting their own logic into the HTML. Remember, inserting the own logic into the HTML, not in the actual server side code. So it is always going to affect the or impact the client side code, which might be HTML, which might be JavaScript, it might be CSS, or it might be any other thing. It might be even some creative XML tags. So now, as you can see, I have one demo available for this. So I have installed a DBWA, is nothing but a small vulnerable web application that you can use to learn multiple web exploitation and attacks on the server. And you can learn and defend and see how you can defend your applications, how you can protect them from the malicious people. So there is one, there are two sections actually in this application. There is a different mode of level of security. You can set your security to low, medium or high. So right now, because I want to demonstrate the attacks, so I'm going to use the security as low security. Okay, so we'll go to the XSS reflected, which is the first type of XSS attack. So their XSS are going to be of two type, XSS reflected and XSS stored. So these are the most common type, but people actually give them another time like or the type like XSS type 0 or type 1, 1, 2, 3. So there are different views. So it doesn't require actually. So there are more two major attacks, reflected and stored. So I'm going to show you the reflected. In the reflected, as you can see, the people are going to type, ask you for the name or whatever your name. Suppose I'll type Toshendra that will say hello Toshendra. So it means whatever I am typing in this box is actually going to reflect or embed back to this page because of the some server side scripts they have on the panel. So this is the most common example wherever you search and on your on the e-commerce website, on whatever website you are using. If you are going to search some product on their website, they said you searched for XYZ. Suppose you searched for laptop, then they will say you searched for laptop. So means if you are putting that laptop in the text box of the search box, that laptop word is going to embed inside the page and will come back from the server. So means you are sending a text to the server and it is coming back to the your browser after embedding inside the web page. Now where is the crack and where is the beauty in this, how we can inject this methodology? Rather than actually putting the name, we can put the script tag, and then the whole script tag will go to the, or the JavaScript tag will go to the server, will then embed inside the HTML and will come back to us. So now whatever what you we will see is we'll see an alert box. Suppose if we are going to put an alert here, so as you can see, I'm going to show you the demo. I'm going to type script and then alert excessive L. Okay. Now we'll let submit. So now as you can see, I can see one small pop-up from the browser saying excesses. Means I have written one small script and now you can see the excesses hello, it is showing nothing. But if you will go and right click on this and go to the inspect element, if you will watch carefully in the browser, if you will go inside this form method tree, if you will try to see, your script tag is already there, right? So I written that script alert excesses high, and instead of saying hello whatever the string I have put, it is just actually embedded the script, and the browser thought that script which came inside this hello or next to the hello is actually the script which the page wants to execute, rather than it just page wants to interpret it. So now how will the browser know whether the script which tag which are coming inside the page are actually solicited or unsolicited, or malicious script tags and non-malicious script tag? So ultimately there is no way for the browser to identify, but it's a responsibility of the developers to actually configure the server something such that, so whenever you see an script tag inside the user request, you need to sanitize it and then send it back, right? So there is a way of making it secure. So let me show you what are the secure version of this. So I'm going to DBWA security. I'll increase the security to high and will submit. I'll go back to this accesses reflected, and this time I will try the same thing, right? I'll try to select the alert and submit. See now, instead of executing the script, the same whole script tag has been printed inside the browser page. So now because it has been printed inside the browser page, so there has to be something creative that the developer has implemented. And if you will go and see into this HTML element of this page, you will right click, inspect element, and you can see very clearly that, see, your whole script has been embedded, and rather it has been executed in the previous low security, but in this case it has been interpreted as a browser, as a text, and then printed on the screen. So now what is the reason behind it, and what is the different source of secure and insecure application, and what was the difference in the server side code while doing this? So this is the code wise difference between the secure and insecure version of the same program, where the reflected can be defended. So if you click on the compare, it will show you very clear cut. So first I am going to show you the normal security or the no security or low security. So as you can see, in the low security I am just trying to see if the name exists in the get array, and if it exists and if it is equal to null or if not equal to null, so I am going to push the hello and the name. right? This is very simple. I'm going to just embed the user submitted input inside the text, and then we'll go to the medium size security, medium security. Here I'm trying to search the script tag in the user submitted text, and we are actually replacing it with the null, or we are deleting the script tag from the user input. But remember, user will never input the only one type of script. The script tag, as you can see, we can always bypass this by putting capital S and then submit it. But as you know, that HTML is not case sensitive. It will accept it as a script tag, and here your defense will be broken. So there, if user will submit capital S inside the script, whole defense will fail and the user will get exploited. But if you see the more security or the high level security, what is the best way of doing this is pass the variable or pass the user submitted data with the HTML special chars function. What this function does in the PHP is, this function will convert the special character like less than symbol or the greater than symbol, which are nothing but the start and the end of the tags, into the HTML entities, which are nothing but ampersand LT, as you can see. Like for example, okay, so as you can see, the for less than symbol in HTML, which is a nothing but like HTML tag start tag or end tag, there is a ampersand LT terminator, and for the same ampersand GT. So this will convert these special symbols into the HTML entities, and whenever the HTML entities will be seen by the browser, it will always print it as a symbol rather than considering it as a part of the HTML tag, right? So this conversion is the responsibility of HTML special char. So these are called HTML entities, and these are not at all executed by the browser, rather they will be interpreted by the browser as a character and will be printed on the screen. So this is the best way to defend your application from the XSS. Okay, so now we have seen the XSS reflected. Now it's time to see some XSS stored attack on the browser. So for the XSS stored, I have a very small the feedback page or the sign guest book, where you can sign the guest book and then enter whatever you want to enter. So I'm going to first reset all these whatever previously entered message I have posted. So for this, I can go to the setup and click on create or reset database. It will reset everything, and we'll go to the XSS stored again, and we'll see there is no message, right? So this I'll go to the security, we'll try to reduce it to low, and we'll submit. Okay, so now in the XSS stored, what we can do is we can even store that alert message inside this box. Okay, so I'll sign this address book, then what will happen, this message will be embedded inside the page and will be stored permanently on the server. So whenever the person will come and visit this page, this script will execute it, which will be stored inside the page. Okay, now we have executed this. So as you can see, this message has been permanently stored. Even if I'll go to some other page and will come back to XSS stored, we'll see the pop-up again. Means the script has been permanently stored. So now I can write any kind of script which can do something like session hijacking. I can steal the cookie from the browser. I can even change the password of the user if it is possible using some URL, and do whatever I want, because I have, and whatever this script I am going to execute, I'll be executing with the permission as a logged in user. So whoever has logged in will be responsible for execution of these scripts. And so I'm going to show you one good demo for this. So I'll be showing you first the AJAX based XSS, where we'll be putting a AJAX script inside the page, and whenever the user will visit this page, a particular AJAX script will try to submit a request in the backend, will try to change the user's password, and user will never know that his password has been changed by the Ajax script. So Ajax, what is Ajax? So Ajax is a asynchronous JavaScript and XML. It is a asynchronous request submission and processing methodology where we can send the HTTP request and in an asynchronous way. Asynchronous means asynchronous way. So asynchronous means without actually impacting the current working of the page, we'll just send the request in the, from the backend, we'll get the response and we'll done. So this is the very creative way to hack someone where he will never know what has been done in the backend. So for an Ajax based exploit, I have one particular script with me. So I have this script which I'll be using. So this script is nothing but I'm going to first include the from the server. So I can include any JavaScript from the server, and after including this script, I'm going to call this function, which is a change password function which I have written inside this script only. So as you can see, this is a change password function which I'm going to call inside this. So I'll just copy, I'll show you the script which I have written here. It is a very simple script. So we'll go to the browser, we'll try to paste it. Okay, so but as you can see, if we'll try to paste it, it will give us a restriction in the number of characters we have. So we can always modify the client side validation or client side whatever the user input sanitizations are there. So as you can see, there is a maximum char function we have. So in the maximum char function, I'm going to change the 50 to 500 so that I should be allowed with the 500 characters. So any client side validation you can suspend by just going to the elements. So I'll just paste it and we'll sign the guest book. Once I sign the guest book, as you can see in the network, there will be a request that will be going to the server, which will be changing my password. Okay. So as you can see in the backend, there is a small GET request that has been submitted without even asking me, and then the request has processed my password and then changed it. I'm showing the small alert on the password just to make sure that we know that yes, password has been changed, but yes, that password alert also that can be suspended into the script. So I'll show you the script exactly what this script exactly is. So this is the very simple script. Okay, so as you can see, this script, so we have a simple function called change password. In this change password, what we are going to do is we're going to send the HTTP request, or sorry, the Ajax request, which is a non-standard way of submitting an Ajax. And after submitting the Ajax, and what exactly we are actually submitting the Ajax, so this is what we are going to submit: open get this URL, which is actually the request for to change the password. This is a special request URL in this DBWA which we are going to use, and this will change the password. So we have included this script first, and after including this script, we just executed this function. It's very simple. And whenever the ready state is 4, means the wherever the HTTP status is 200, means we have received the request or we have actually processed the request. You just show an alert. So I can suspend this alert anytime, and I can just submit this request anytime, any number of times without hurting anything. So this is the simple example of Ajax based stored XSS, which can be very dangerous in terms of changing the password, submitting the any kind of request to the server without letting the user know that what kind of request he or she has submitted. So the request can be sending a friend request to someone, sending an email to a particular user. So all these requests can be submitted, depends upon the server and the kind of scripts we have. Okay, now the second kind of attack would be, the second XSS would be stored XSS. I'm going to show you the how we can steal the cookie of a user, okay, and store it into the server of the hacker server by using the stored XSS. So the exploit is going to be this. Okay, so this is a small exploit which will steal the cookie of a user who will be logging in, who will be visiting that page, and will submit the cookie to the server. And as you can see, that server which will receive the cookie is going to be the localhost slash demo slash XSS slash stored slash getdata.php. So getdata.php is a small script which will just take the argument which is coming and will store it inside the info.txt file. So I'll show you the code as well of this getdata.php. So here's the code of getdata.php. This, as you can see, this is a very simple code which is just opening a file or which is the info.txt on the server in the append mode, and will start writing the lines and iterate for the each request which is coming as a key and value, and we'll write into the file, and we'll after that it will put some new lines character which is slash r slash n, and we'll then close the file. This is very simple, just fetch the whatever is coming and then store it inside the file, nothing more than this. And now this script is being stored on the malicious server, so you can consider that this server can be a malicious server. It can be www.xyzhacker.com/getdata.php, right? So as a I'm going to store this document.write. As you can see, what we are doing exactly here is we are going to create some variables which are cookies, which are document.cookies, where cookies underscore request is equal to cookies.replace. So which we are just replace some characters, and we filtered them out like semicolon and star, number of spaces with the and sign. So we are just executing some regular expression, and after that we are actually executing document.write, which will create an element inside the web page and will create a DOM object or the DOM element inside the current DOM, and will create an image tag. Here the source of the image would be this, where obviously the source of the image should be an image file, but where what we are trying to do is we are trying to create an source which is exactly the hacker's URL. So what will happen, this image will be this browser will try to render this image, will try to open this URL, and while it is opening this URL, it will actually accidentally will submit the cookie to the server. So rather than opening the image from the URL, it will access this URL and will try to submit the cookie to the server. So which is obviously unfortunate. This is not something that browser might think that might happen, but this is something creative. Okay, so I'm going to paste this entire thing as Control C, and we'll go back to the stored accesses part. So as you can see, two alert will execute. One is for the accesses, another would be for the changing the password which has been changed. Now I'm going to paste this, since there is a limit of the word. As you can see, if I'll paste this, it will give me the limit of the word. So I can suspend this limit by going to the inspect element and change the maximum word, maximum length to 500. So now I can Control A, delete, and then Control V, then sign the guest book. So since I'm going to sign the guest book, the two pop-up are old, which will just execute as it is. And the third one, as you can see in the network, there will be one request which is on getdata.php. So there is a third request that has been submitted for the getdata.php, and once this request would have been submitted, this will receive the cookie and on the server. So I'll show you the folder. This is the folder where we are actually going to store the info.txt. So if I'm going to open the info.txt here, I have just opened the info.txt, and we have a cookie now from the browser. So there are two elements, security and PHP session ID. So we were able to steal the session ID of the element. As you know, if you can steal the session ID of a PHP session, you can even hijack the complete session and will steal it, right? So session stealing and session hijacking can be done using this attack. So that's why the exercise is being considered very dangerous attack, because there are lots of different variants that you can create, and different unique attacks you can create using the XSS. So this is about the XSS stored. Yeah, the players, I think we were talking about this, the attacker, the company's web server and the client. So there is a server and there is a client. So all the attacks which we are making for the XSS are actually the client side attack mostly, and some of them are server side because they are storing the information on the server, which on a permanent basis. Some people are calling it a order, like second order, first order. So these are nothing but a stored and a reflected attacks, and nothing more than this. So website can be defaced temporarily or permanently. Defaced means somebody can put a funny face on your website page, and whenever people will come and visit it, they will find that image or text very offensive, and then the whole thing can go bad because people will never come back to your website because your website has been hacked, so they can never come back. So it's nothing but a user's trust which you are breaking, and once user trust is broken means nobody will come back to use that website. So ultimately the website business and the image can be lost, and the user session can be stolen in a very dangerous way. I have shown you one example of stealing the PHP session session variable, and then after that you can continue stealing the complete session. And there are lots of other dangerous attack that you can create, and accesses is not limited to these things. There are so many varieties, so many vulnerabilities related to the accesses are available. So you should be very careful considering the accesses. So the best way is to defend the accesses is always sanitize the user input. Consider the users are always going to send the malicious input, always. And then what steps are required to protect your assets, protect your information and server, you will take. Never consider that, yes, developers generally always consider that whatever the users input are going to be, they're going to be the generic users. No, they are not always going to be the generic user. There will be some malicious small script kiddie or hacker who will try to come and will try to play with your website. So always consider these people in mind and then design your applications.
If you have queries regarding this session, please press the hand raise.
I am Deb Shekhar.
Yeah, hi.
I have a query related to username and password of operating system. I don't know operating system where they store the username and password. If they store the password in a database, can we use the SQL injection to log in inside the Windows or the Linux?
No, actually they don't store the username and password into the database. They have a very creative system where they store it. These are called keys actually. As you might have that there is a key based system in the user Windows. So stealing the username and password of the Windows user is not possible, but yes, there is a very creative way of resetting the username password without even logging in, and accessing the admin account of Windows 7 or Windows 8 without actually deleting the previous account. So suppose the window is locked, you want to log in, right? And you want to access the particular data inside this. So there is a way of creating a new user, right? And allocate or assign the permission of that new user as a admin and then log in as a that user. And you can even after login in, you can delete the previous authentic user. So ultimately you will own the machine after that. So this you can Google. I think there is a lots of resource available on this. We also have a blog on this, like how to reset the Windows admin password. So there is a session available, but SQL injection is not the answer for this, that's for sure.
Question about this, I've explained about SQL injection and access view, okay? So if any website is there and how to check that particular website is vulnerable, what are the step by step process to check the all the vulnerability of the particular website?
Okay, so you are saying what are the step by step process to identify whether the website is vulnerable or not, right? This is your question, right? So see, there are actually lots of security scanners available on the internet which will help you in identifying the security bugs in your websites. So they will just scan the website and then will give you the report, vulnerability report. Like, and there are lots of open source scanners also available on the internet. So if you see the OWASP page, there are around more than 10 open source security scanners are available. Like Nessus is one of them. Nessus is a very good, and then people use Metasploit as well to scan the vulnerabilities on the website, and Equinix, which is a paid version, but it is very good. So these are the few softwares you can use to identify the vulnerability. And if you see the URL on the internet and you want to check whether this URL is hackable or not, then if the URL is having a certain structure in form of question mark, right, and then ID is equal to XYZ, then put the single quote at the end of the XYZ. Just put the single quote at the end of the XYZ, and we'll see if the page throws an error. If the page throws an error, it means there is no sanitization at the server side, and you can start exploiting the server in terms of the other SQL injection commands, right? And there are lots of SQL injection command tools available. Even I have it right now. You just pass the URL and then press the button. That's it. You don't even have to do the entire, you know, SQL injection query and, you know, crafting the union, this and that. You just paste the URL and then plus inject. So they will scan and attack your whole system. So I think automated scanners are the solution. But yes, manual audits are one of them. And manual audits are very expensive, very time consuming, and need some experts, right? So not everyone can manually inspect a code and see whether it's hackable.
I have one question. Yes. Can we perform SQL and SQL injection and cross-site SQL things simultaneously?
Yes, yes, we can. There are lots of you know, options available in performing the SQL injection and cross-site scripting. See, cross-site scripting is nothing but a way of sending and fetching the data, right? So it's like client to server. The communication is can be designed by the XSS, and what you are sending inside the XSS or whatever the script you are writing, like for example, the in the AJAX query, I can write a query to submit the form, right? And in that form, I can send a SQL query. So it's like joining the SQL injection and XSS. Using XSS like AJAX, we'll be submitting the request, and in that request, we'll perform the SQL injection. So both the things can be merged. So it's like, you know, there is a construction. There are two tools. One is for one purpose, another for another. If you use both tools, maybe your productivity might increase, or you might exploit more information very quickly. It can happen.
Thank you, sir.
I would like to know more on DOM-based XSS.
Yeah.
And so, question number two. Yeah. Also, like, I would like to know whether there are any new attack vectors other than SQL injection and XSS and click jacket. I mean, these been around for a while. So, did you see any other new vectors?
New attack vectors, right? So, yes. I'll say first is the DOM-based attack. So, DOM-based attack, I have one demo, but I'm very much, I'm not confident about showing it because it's a university, Indian university, which is having a DOM-based exploit on their website. So, like for example, so I've shown you that Windows.document or Windows.write or document.write, whoever accesses, whatever accesses using these commands for manipulating the HTML elements of a DOM object, these are called DOM-based accesses. So, everything will remain same, except that they will be using the document dot star objects or the DOM objects. So these are called DOM based accesses. And the second about the new kind of attack, yes, there are lots of new attacks which are available. Heartbleed is one of them. I think you might have heard that there's a very creative attack where it was a vulnerability in the SSL implementation in OpenSSL. And except this, in the web based application, DOS attacks are nowadays very common, where people are actually submitting the request in a very creative way and trying to suspend the operation of a website, and we call it a denial of service attack, right? And denial of service attack has taken another level by going into the DDoS, denial of distributed service attack, where we will be trying to send through multiple requests to the server from distributed servers, right? And multiple servers. So these are another creative attack. And then authentication bypassing cookie manipulations are one of these, which are not only a SQL injection, people actually implement a code which can be broken in the multiple way. So there are lots of ways to hack it, and SQL injection and cross-site scripting actually cover more than 30-40% of the vulnerabilities available on the web applications, and the variety of these vulnerabilities are more than any other of them, right? Like header injection attack is one of them. Like header injection attack, we try to inject the certain information using the HTML header which we are actually submitting from user to server. So the thumb rule will remain same. Whenever you are getting something from the user, even if it is a header, even if it is a request header, you're supposed to sanitize it. Consider that there might be malicious input from the user. That's the answer.
One more question. I mean, what are the new attack vectors you see on Android platform?
So we are actually working on the Android applications security, and from the company side, we are launching appvigil.co, a SaaS-based or cloud-based Android app security scanner. It will help people to scan the security vulnerabilities in their Android application, and will give a report in a very detailed manner by pinpointing the package name, class name, and the method where the vulnerability exists. So we have written a static source code analyzer for Android application security. So in Android application, actually the intent spoofing is one of the big problem nowadays, where whenever the intent are being transmitted to the one application to another application, they can be actually spoofed. So if you are not setting up the permission in your application, or whenever you are creating an application, you are not setting the permission in a proper way, or restricting the broadcast, sticky broadcast, or another kind of broadcast, then it might create a problem for the application. So that's the Android security. There are lots of problems.
If I am setting a private cloud, in which layer we have to prevent this SQL injection?
So see, the cloud providers never provide security at the server level. So once you install the server, after the installation, like application level security is your responsibility. Like we are using Amazon cloud, and we found that Amazon is responsible for one server to another server based communication and the security of the server. But after the server, if you install a vulnerable application and your application is being hacked, then it's your responsibility. So OS level security is being provided by the Amazon, but the application level security is your responsibility. So you have to deploy the defenses in the application which you are creating. Second, while you are configuring the cloud, you need to make sure that the permissions you are giving to access the one server by the outer world or one server from another server has to be properly configured. Like for example, you may give permission on all the ports on a server which you are not supposed to give, right? You want to give a permission only on port 80, right? And for the web access, rest of the server you want to suspend. But sometime what happened, just for the sake of working, you just give permission, all the permission to the server. So such kind of security is your responsibility. And in the cloud, there are different subnetwork. So you need to make sure that whether you are creating the subnetwork public or private. So if you are creating a server which you want to remain in your, like for example, database server, so you would like to create the database server inside the private network rather than the public subnet. Because obviously you can share the database to the third world, outer world, without even any problem. So there are lots of configuration security you can also access.
We have three questions.
Yeah.
First one, how to check the vulnerability of website and what kind of tool can we use for it?
So how to check the vulnerability of a website is, like, one is a manual option, which is obviously time consuming, and you can go to a form, try to submit a script, try to submit a SQL query inside the form and see what happens. So it's like hit and trial method. Yes, it is successful and it is time consuming, and you need to have a good knowledge about the SQL query and the vulnerabilities before actually going for this method. The second option is the tool which are available, and these, most of the tools are open source and free, and you can log into the OWASP website. There are list of OWASP security scanners available for free, which are open source, non-commercial tool, right? And you can even design these tools, you can contribute into these tools by forking the repository, and the success of these tools are not 100%, of course. They will be like 50 to 60% successful, but if you want a very deep analysis, then I think you have to jump manually for scanning the vulnerability and identifying.
Suppose there is a SQL injection attack or XSS attack, and how will we identify it and how to overcome it from it?
Okay, so I think identification, I have told you that whenever there is a SQL injection, if you submit the form or whenever you submit the user input to the server, if you pass a single quote inside the string, the whole query will disturb. So that's how you can detect the SQL injection attack. Defending the SQL injection is use a parameterized query, where you actually create the query not by just passing the variable into the query, but by using some creative parameterized objects which are available in Java. And for the PHP, there is a function called mysql_scape_string function, which will help you in escaping certain special characters using the forward slash, so that your special characters like single quote, ampersand, or @ symbol should not have a special meaning in this string. So like escaping this string is the one answer. And parameterized query using the JDBC objects or the classes are the best option for defending the application.
So one more question, sir.
Yes.
So if suppose I have a website,
okay,
and there is an attack SQL or SSS, whatever it may be.
Okay.
And the hacker has changed the password of my website or admin password.
Okay.
How can I get back my password?
See, you
and
have
how can I get back my website?
Okay, see, first thing is like you have a admin root username and password with you, right? So until unless you are not giving the root username and password to the server or he is not able to get it, then I think you can protect it. But if he got the access to the root username and password, then I think you have to contact the companies from where you purchased the server so that they should give you the access back, because that would be a big deal.
First question is whether we can monitor SQL injection through server log files.
See, if you have set up the logs properly, by default these logs are not available like this. So if you buy a server and you will start setting up the MySQL server on the that application, then by default the logs will not be available. If you are smart enough to set up a logs threshold to debug level and store every query which is coming from the user and then monitoring it, then only it is possible. So I will say by default it is not available, you have to manually set up. Yes, it is possible to track the SQL injection attack through logs.
What are the effective remedy for SQL injection?
Effective remedy, see, once it is being done, then you need to identify where are the points where you are taking the input from the user and without sanitizing you are passing it to the query. Here you need to fix these first points, and then after that clean the database, format everything, and then go ahead, because you are not sure if user has or the hacker has uploaded a small malware or the backdoor somewhere in the corner of your server. So you need to make sure, and you need to scan the whole server to make sure that it is safe. Now
can we minimize false alarm ratio in SQL injection?
So you want to do minimize the false positive in SQL injection? It doesn't make sense to me right now. So it means you are trying to say, if you are setting up, you have set up a detection system on your server, and you want to check whether the SQL injection are being done by a user, and it should not give a false alarm to you, right? So first you need to set up a system, a tracking system, which will track the user SQL injection which is coming from the user, and if it has found some SQL injection, then you have to raise an alarm, right? So reducing the false positive is applicable in that case only. Otherwise, if somebody is hacking, then there is no sense of false positive.
Can you explain us the sanitization, use of sanitization?
Yeah.
It is used for the verification from the server side for the user.
Yeah, so
that I understood by giving a colon.
So you okay? So I'll just show you in the presentation. Suppose we are having a function called sanitize. Virtually, it is a function which will sanitize everything. So what is the difference between using a sanitization and without using a sanitization? So I'll say if you are using this function like this, sanitize, right? And you are passing a string which is inside this these double quotes and is nothing like A B C single quote, X, Y, Z, and then percentage symbol, and then 1, 2, 3, and then ampersand symbol, and this. So these are the string, this is the string which you are passing to this sanitize function. If you will obviously not use the sanitize function, then this string will remain as it is and will cause a problem to the server. But if you use this function, then the return variable would be something like this, A, B, C, forward slash, single quote, X, Y, Z, forward slash, percentage, 1, 2, 3, forward slash, ampersand. So now this string will become an actual string and will have no impact on the server, and will run this as a, and server will or the MySQL will consider it as a normal string without having any problem. So this is called sanitization. This is one example of sanitization. Beside this, there are lots of different ways, and it depends on the different cases that what is the sanitization. Suppose I'll say, even I'll say letter A, small a, is considered malicious to me, right? Then sanitization for me means removing this A, simple. So sanitization actually depends upon this server which is considering which part as a malicious part. Like for example, if for MySQL, percentage and the single quotes are the malicious, right? So these are the sanitization.
So my question is, how we can bypass the high security XSS level and then how to prevent it?
Well, see, you have to came up with some creative, you know, attack vectors by using some methodology like special character sequence, which might create some defense, which might bypass the defense. Like for example, I told you that the defense which has been applied on the server was replacing the string script tag, right? So if somebody will put capital S in the script tag, it will bypass. So your bypassing methodology will depends upon the server's defense, whether it is weak or high or very strong. I'll say if it is very strong, it is monitoring everything, defending everything, it will be really hard to bypass it, right? And second question was?
And then how to prevent it?
How to prevent? I think I have shown the function for this, HTML entities. There is a function called HTML special chars or HTML entities in PHP, and similarly in other languages, there is a function available for converting special characters into HTML entities and then processing it to the server. Except this, user input sanitization is the thumb rule for any kind of defense. So these are the way to defend it.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah, thank you.